What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. If you are a senior Java developer, or if you are even still learning the language, there is no doubt that you have encountered and used the classes that extend the collection and map interfaces. In this video, we will do our best to go over these classes and explain when and how each one should be used. Let's start with the collection interface and take a look at some of the most used classes and interfaces that implement and extend it. As you can see, there is quite a few, so we are going to kind of separate them into clusters to be able to dive in the details of each one easily. So, the first interface that extends the collection one is the list interface. If you have seen some of our previous videos, you should be familiar with the concept of lists by now. The list interface, or abstract data type, has several implementations, as you can see. We can have a list with an array, or a linked list as its underlying implementation. And these are represented by the ArrayList and LinkedList classes, respectively. It is preferable to initialize both the ArrayList and LinkedList classes using the List interface in Java. Or as a general advice, always try to show or expose the methods and functionalities of your interfaces rather than your implementations, because, well, that's what interfaces are here for. Now, the Vector class is actually similar to the ArrayList one. But the only difference it has is the synchronization. Vectors are thread-safe, whereas array lists and linked lists aren't. So, for performance reasons, if we do not need our application to be safe within several threads, then we are better off using array lists. A vector in Java can also be initialized using the list reference if we are not making use of functionalities specific to the vector class. As for stack class, it extends the vector class. So when you need to use the last-in-first-out structure, also known as LIFO structure, offered by Java, it will be synchronized by default, and it will use an array as its underlying implementation. But here we have to initialize it using the implementation, using the stack class. If we initialize it using the list class, which we can obviously do as it extends it, we won't be able to use the stack functionalities such as pop, push, or peek. And this has a major impact on the use of stacks in Java, and on the definition and role of interfaces as a whole. However, this was later resolved with the introduction of the deck class, which we will cover in a bit. The second part or cluster of the diagram you can see are the classes and interfaces related to the queue interface, which also extends the collection interface. Queues define a first-in-first-out structure, also known as FIFO structure. And one of its implementation is the priority queue, as you can see, which instead of dequeuing the first item in the queue, will dequeue the item with the highest priority. Heaps, which we will cover in a future video, are one maximally efficient implementation of the priority queues. If we want to use a non-prioritized queue, or just a normal FIFO queue structure, we have two implementations, the array deck and the linked list. And here you can guess their respective underlying implementations. In order to make use of arrays or linked lists as queues, they have to be initialized, as you can see in front of you, using the queue interface. You may have also noticed that the queue interface is extended by another interface, which is the deck interface. Deck actually stands for double-ended queue, which means that it can be accessed from both ends. Therefore, this interface offers both the LIFO structure, the one used in stacks and deck's default behavior, and the FIFO structure, the one used in queues. It has the same two underlying implementations as the queue interface, the linked list and the array deck, which uses an array similarly to the stack class, the one that extends the list interface. However, array decks aren't synchronized by default. It is preferable and advised by Java's documentation to use decks instead of stacks while coding in Java for several reasons. Some are that the deck interface offers the ability to switch between both the linked list and array implementations, whereas the stack, as it extends the vector, only offers the array option. Most importantly, you are better off using decks because of their consistency. Stacks extend vectors, so while implementing, you will be allowed to access any item in the stack, not just the item at the top of the stack, as the stack definition says. In the example you can see, even though the stack object was initialized using the stack class, we are still able to retrieve the second item stacked, whereas in the object initialized using the deck interface, we are not able to see past the top of the deck or the stack. And this is what the correct representation of the LIFO structure should look like. Another reason is that stacks are synchronized, and if you do not need the synchronization aspect in your application, this will lead to unnecessary slight performance degradation. DECs, on the other hand, are not synchronized, but upon need can be made thread safe. The third cluster on our list is the set interface and its classes. The set is basically a list, but with unique values only. No duplicates are allowed inside it. So, sets offer two implementations. The hash set, which is backed by a hash table, hence objects that we insert in a hash set are not guaranteed to be inserted in the same order as objects that are inserted based on their hash code. And the second implementation offered is the linked hash set, which is basically an ordered version of the hash set that maintains a doubly linked list across all elements to maintain the order of insertion. The set interface is extended by another interface, which is the sorted set implemented by the tree set. And you may have already guessed the difference here. The tree set actually sorts the set of unique items stored inside it in ascending order by default. The lines of code you see are one way to actually initialize all the implementations of the set interface we just covered. And there you have it, all the classes and interfaces of the collection interface. Now onwards to the map interface. And as you can see, we have quite a few classes to cover here as well. So let's get to it. Similarly to the hash set and sorted set, here we have the hash map, which is the basic implementation of the map interface. And we have the sorted map implemented by the tree map. Tree maps will sort their elements by keys and are not synchronized. Now, the difference between a hash map and a hash table is that a hash map is not synchronized. It is not thread safe and cannot be shared between many threads without proper code synchronization, whereas hash table is synchronized and is thread safe. Additionally, hash map allows one null key and multiple null values, whereas hash table doesn't allow any null key or value. So, hash maps are generally preferred over hash tables if thread synchronization is not needed. Finally, we have the enum map implementation. The difference between enum map and hash map is that enum map is optimized for enum keys, while hash map is a general purpose map implementation similar to hash table. You cannot use any type other than enums as key in an enum map, but you can use both enums and any other object as key in a hash map. Due to this specialization done for enum keys, enum maps will perform better than hash maps when using enums as the key object. And this is due to the very low probability of collision when using enum maps with enums. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.